left off then, nope, that's not the right page. I want to pick up with what's called Fit 16, line 1050. We left off on Tuesday. Beowulf had defeated Grendel, and we didn't talk about this very much. But after he defeats Grendel, the Danes follow the trail of gore that Grendel left behind, and they make their way to the mere that he lives in. They never actually find his body. But they see things in the mirror. They see, you know, sea monsters, and were given a description of the mirror and such. And then as they ride on their way back, an old Shope sings songs about Beowulf and celebrates Beowulf and compares Beowulf to probably the greatest hero in all of Germanic literature, a guy named Sigismund. And alludes to the myth of, or the story, of Sigismund killing the dragon. Okay? It's telling that the poet does this early in the poem, and does this in this section of the poem, because as we're going to see when we get to the end of the poem, Beowulf dies killing a dragon. Sigismund did not die in killing the dragon Fafnir. He went on to live afterwards. But by the poet comparing Beowulf to this Germanic hero, the poet is suggesting Beowulf ranks up there with Sigismund. Okay? Then they go back and we see the big celebration. We see Beowulf receiving all of this treasure from Hrothgar, which begins around line 10:10 or so. And we're told, ...10:20, he gives to Beowulf the blade of Halfdane, that is his father's blade, okay, which in traditional Germanic custom, that blade would be handed down to his eldest son. Okay. Now, Hrothgar says essentially to Beowulf, I take you as a son. He doesn't literally adopt him, but he says, in my heart, you're like a son. Okay? Which is going to bother his wife, and we're going to hear some words from her about that later on. What else? He gives him a golden war standard. He gives him a banner. He gives him a helmet. He gives him a coat of mail. Okay? He gives him 8 horses. Just all kinds of stuff. Then he also distributes treasure. This is beginning around line 1050. He begins distributes treasure to all of Beowulf's men. What did they do? How much did they help Beowulf? Not at all. Did they try? Yes, they at least tried. I mean, they did pull out their swords. They did whack on Grendel. Didn't do any good. Okay. No sword could harm Grendel, but they tried, okay? Even though Beowulf told them before, this is my battle, okay? He gives treasure for Honshu, the man that Grendel ate. And notice line 1054. Well, let's start with 1053.5. And then ordered that gold be paid for the man whom Grendel had wickedly slain. He, this is Grendel, would have done more if wise God and one man's courage had not prevented that fate. He, Grendel, would have done more. That is, he would have killed more than just Honshu if, notice what the poet then says, God and what? One man's courage had not prevented that fate. Notice the poet doesn't say if God had not prevented that fate, putting the responsibility entirely in God's hands, nor does he put the responsibility entirely in Beowulf's hands. The poet links the two. Okay? The Maker ruled all of the race of mankind, as he still does. This is another one of those passages that I described the other day. Another one of those gnomic passages or wisdom or proverb kind of verses, okay? Notice what the poet is saying, and let me throw this out here too. You have to make a distinction between the Christian poet, okay, and the pagan world in which Beowulf is set. Okay? Beowulf, as I said the other day, it's set in the mid-6th century. Okay? Denmark and southern Sweden. Right? Christianity hadn't reached those areas. It doesn't reach those areas until about the 10th century. Okay? They stay pagan until then. The poet, however, is Christian. We're almost entirely sure that that's the case. At the very least, the person who writes the poem in the manuscript that survives, that contains it, is definitely Christian. Okay? It survives from a manuscript that is dated to right around 1000 AD. So what we have is we have this Christian poet looking back on a pre-Christian period. Okay? And what he's doing is he's celebrating these pre-Christian pagans. In other words, he's looking at them, and he's looking at them with some fondness. He's looking at them with some glory. That is, they got some things right. Yeah, they got some things wrong also, which we'll talk about before we finish the poem. Okay? But one of the things they get right is their idea of courage. Their idea of fighting to the end, no matter what. Okay? So the poet goes on. The Maker ruled all of the race of mankind, as he still does. Notice the tense of the first part of that sentence. Ruled. Back then. Okay? Mid-6th century. God was in control. As he still does. And that means at the time, okay, that the poet, whoever the poet is composing this poem. And if you read the introduction, and you need to read the introduction, if you read the introduction, you realize, you know, when Beowulf was composed is a real tricky question. Okay? It's one of the most hotly debated issues in scholarship, because some people want to say it's early as 650 to 700, and it can be much later than that, all the way up to about 1035. It's about the latest anybody has suggested that it was written. The manuscript pretty much limits when it can be dated. Okay, it really can't be dated. That 1035 is kind of outside the boundaries. The manuscript really can't be any older than about 1025, just on the basis of the letter forms in it. Letter forms, English handwriting, until about 1100 or so, can be dated to about 15 to 25 year blocks of time. Okay, so we know the manuscript's really not later than about 1025. So the poet could be writing this in the year 1000, in which case when the poet says, the Maker ruled all the race of mankind way back then, as he still does, he means as of right now, in 1000 AD. Therefore, understanding is always best. Spiritual foresight. He clarifies what is meant by understanding. Spiritual foresight, that is kind of seeing into the deeper meanings of things. He must face much, both love and hate, who long here endures this world in these days of strife. That's the spiritual force that he's talking about. Okay? Why include this little piece of gnomic wisdom at this point? I mean, this is the point everybody's celebrating. And what does the speaker kind of suggest here? Notice, he must face much. Much what? Love and hate. Who long here endures this world in these days of strife. In other words, life isn't what? Yeah. And he's kind of suggesting, and it's not meant to be. This is a place of trial. Okay? And survival. Exactly. Notice, you have to survive what? Love. Well, that's pretty easy. That's enjoying. Okay? But hate? No. Hate's what you endure. Okay?
Do you think he's kind of foreshadowing a little bit of what happens later?
Yeah. Yeah, and I think the poet, frankly, there is talking about what is going on in at the time that he is composing this poem. Okay? I think the poem does not have an early date, that is, in terms of its composition. I don't think it dates from the 600s or 700s or even the 800s. I think it dates probably from the 900s. And possibly the late 900s, okay? But even if it is the 800s, any time after 793, okay, would kind of complicate things. Why? Because what happened in the year 793? The Vikings start invading, okay? Anglo-Saxon England. And the Viking invasions are not, you know, these aren't peaceful migrations. These are bloodthirsty, raping, murdering pillagers. The way they first start coming is they come down and they just hit the coastal towns or monasteries. Okay? Monasteries were a big target simply because they had a lot of gold. Monasteries would have a book of the Gospels, just the four Gospels. And that book would have a book cover, and the cover would likely be made of gold or silver. Why? To indicate the value of what's within. Okay? And that Gospel book would have jewels or gemstones embedded within that cover, like rubies and topaz and such. Okay? So the Vikings would hit those monasteries to steal all of those kinds of covers, to steal, you know, what's called the paten or the chalice that the Eucharist would be delivered, given to the monks and such in. Okay? The Vikings weren't Christian, and they didn't leave survivors, at least for the initial few decades of the Viking raids. Okay? They would go in and they would kill everyone and take everything that they could. Anything that had any value at all, they took it. Okay, so if you date Beowulf even to, say, somewhere between 800 and 1000 AD, you've got this going on. Okay, and it presents, obviously, then some problems. Why? Because the Vikings are the direct descendants of the culture that is celebrated here. Whether you're talking about the Danes or the Geats. Okay? They're all Scandinavians. And so here you've got these people who are being celebrated here, and their grandchildren, okay, essentially being written about in the poem. Or these people that are being celebrated here, let me rephrase that, and their grandchildren are raiding, raping, pillaging, and murdering your countryside. Kind of a problem there. Yeah, doesn't really make sense. If you're a poet living in England, just pick a random year, in the year 850, and you've got these raids going on, Why do you write a poem celebrating the ancestors of the people who are raiding you? Okay? It's kind of difficult to wrap your head around. One possibility is that the poem is written in a part of northern England that's under Viking control. It's written in Anglo-Saxon because it's written for kind of two audiences. A Viking audience, which a Viking audience that has settled down in Anglo-Saxon England by 850 is already going to have begun intermarrying with Anglo-Saxons. Okay? The languages are close enough where you can converse. Okay? And after Vikings had been there for 25, 30 years, they would have picked up Anglo-Saxon. Okay? And Anglo-Saxons would have picked up Old Norse. So they would have been able to talk and communicate. Okay? So there's a possibility that the poem was written in an area dominated by Vikings, but it's written for an Anglo-Saxon kind of lower level of society. Anglo-Saxons, in other words, under Norse or Viking rule. Okay? So when the poet says, "The Maker ruled all of the race of mankind, as he still does," that could be the poet kind of suggesting to his audience, you know, God was in control back then when they were having a hard time, and God is still in control now. Kind of like when we are having a hard time. And if you're going to live long in this world, because notice that is how he prefaces the next thing, "He must face much, both love and hate, who long here endures." If you're going to live a long time in this life, you're going to suffer. Yeah, you're going to have love too, but you're going to suffer. Okay? And then the poet kind of realizes, I'm getting on my soapbox. I better get back off. "Noise and music mingle together before the leader of Halfdane's forces." In other words, little wisdom passage over, let's get back to the poem at hand. Okay? And what does the poet immediately do? He tells a story, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm having to drink a lot of water because I mowed for like 3 hours just and I've got dust all over my throat and lungs. The poet puts in the mouth of a shope. A shope is a performer. Like later in the Middle Ages, a person would have been called a minstrel or a troubadour, okay? Puts in the mouth of the shope a song. And he sings a song about what's essentially called the Finnsburg Fragment or the Lay of Finn, okay? It's called in the poem the Finnsburg Episode. Finnsburg just means the fortification of Finn, okay? Name of a character. And what we get in the Finnsburg episode is a tale about a man named Finn who has a sister named Hildebur, okay? And, excuse me, a wife named Hildebur. You have Finn, he is a Frisian. And you have the Danes over here. They are led by a man named Hnaf, who has a sister named Hildebur. Okay. They are the children of a man named Hulk. Okay. Finn and Hildebur marry. They have a son who's never named. Okay. The Frisians and the Danes are kind of in open conflict. They hate each other. And there's a feud between them. And the poet says, Hildebur is given in marriage to Finn to attempt to bring peace between these two warring tribes. Okay? So, Hildeberg goes to live with Finn at Finsburg. This B-U-R-G-H, this is like borough, Finsboro. It's where the B-O-R-O in Murfreesboro essentially comes from, okay? One day, Knaff, her brother, comes to visit. He comes with a troop of soldiers, okay, because he doesn't go anywhere without a troop of soldiers. And while at Finsburg, Knaff and the Danes are attacked by Finn's own people. In doing so, Finn's people break an age-old custom. And when I say age-old, I mean older than the Germanic people, older than the English, older than the Irish, older than the Russians. This age-old principle is what's called an Indo-European idea. It goes back to about 5, 6,000 BC, okay, to the original tribe of people that later dispersed and gave us Greeks and Italians and Germans and Russians and Indians, as in the continent of India, that kind of India, okay, etc., right? I mean, this is a long time ago. This is an idea held by them. And the idea is that of hospitality. Okay? Hospitality. Someone comes to your door, or someone comes and stays with you, they are automatically under your protection. They're in your home, your duty is to defend them. You do not, under any circumstances, attack them. In fact, this duty of hospitality was held so strongly by the Indo-European people. And we know this because it shows up in their mythology, in the mythology of all the national races that break down from the Indo-Europeans. This duty was so strong that it even held that if your enemy comes to your door at night, say in the middle of a pelting snowstorm, knocks on your door, you are bound to open the door and give that person shelter for the evening. And even though they're your sworn enemy, while they're under your roof, they're under your protection. Okay? So, Knaff, with his troops, goes to visit his sister. His sister's husband, or his men at least, attack. Okay? And essentially a draw is reached. That is, Finn's men don't get the upper hand, but Knaff's men kind of do, but they don't annihilate the Finn people, the Frisians. Instead, they do this. If you grew up in a large family, if you know anybody who did, this kind of arrangement may have obtained in your home at one point or another. You've got the Germanic hall like this, and they essentially do this. They essentially draw a curtain across the hall, and they say, the Frisians stay here, and the Danes stay here. Okay. For the simple reason that it's winter. And the Danes can't leave because they're seafaring people, and the Rhine River, okay, which is where they are at, Finsburg, Finn's castle, was apparently somewhere along the Rhine, was frozen over, the poem tells us. Okay, so they can't leave. So, even though they divide the room like this for the Danes to stay here and the Frisians stay here, during the time that they are bound together, they do have meals together. That is, they don't totally separate from each other and have no interaction. It's just that for most of the time, they have no interaction just to keep things on an even keel. Okay? A truce is declared. But springtime comes. And what happens? The Danes attack. The Danes have reason to attack. What is it? They were attacked first. Okay? They're going to, quote-unquote, end the feud. Because what happened in the initial attack of the Frisians against the Danes? Hnaf was killed. Okay? Finn was killed. And Hildebur and Finn's son was killed. Okay? Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. So when spring comes, the rivers are navigable again. The Danes attack and they annihilate at least this little group of Frisians. Okay? And Hildebur goes back to the land of the Danes with Hnaf's right-hand man, a guy named Hengist. Okay? And we get this, you know, this beautiful little interlude in this episode of how Hildebur suffers. Okay? Here's my question. Beowulf just killed Grendel. Why are they singing this depressing song? This isn't Beowulf, you just killed Grendel. What are you going to do next? You know, go to Disney World. No. Hear a song about death and destruction and annihilation. Okay. Why? Because it's about the feud. It's about this idea of feud. Okay. Why is this important? What's going to happen this very night? Grendel's mother comes. Why does Grendel's mother come to Harrod? To avenge her son. To avenge her son on whom? Doesn't matter. Her son died as a result of going there. She's going to avenge him on anybody. Okay? So, when Beowulf killed Grendel, what did Beowulf do? He opened a feud. See, Beowulf got himself involved in a feud he wasn't personally involved in. Who was personally involved in the previous feud? Hrothgar and Grendel. Okay? So now Beowulf has involved himself in a feud with Grendel's mother. She comes, she kills the man named Asherah. Okay, skip all that. Hold on. But before we get there, sorry, I'm jumping ahead of myself. The Finnsburg episode ends around line 1156 or so. And we're told 1159, the lay was sung, the entertainer's song, glad sounds rose again, the bench noise glittered, cupbearers gave wine, blah, blah, blah. Okay? Well, Theal, Hrothgar's wife, comes forth in her golden crown to see where the good two sat, nephew and uncle. Okay? Nephew and uncle. Back to over here for a second. Nephew and uncle. Okay? The Hildebur, the Finnsburg episode suggests, it doesn't state this, but it suggests these two die killing each other. In other words, they become what? That we've already heard about Unferth.
Kinslayers.
They become kinslayers. Okay? Here's a problem. Okay, first, that's a major problem in Germanic culture. Here's the other problem. This relationship, okay, nephew to uncle, but specifically nephew to sister's brother is the closest relationship in Germanic society. It's closer than father and son. Okay? And here's one of the reasons at least why. In a typical Germanic culture, king, tribal kind of society, This son, let me put it this way.
Is it a matriarch?
No, not really. You'd have father, son, sister, and her husband, etc. And sister has a son, okay? In this kind of society, if she and her husband had a son, typically what would happen is at a certain age, probably 5, 6, 7, something like that, this son would be sent to live with her brother, okay, to be trained in how to be a man, how to be a warrior, how to be a soldier. Possibly, if this is a chieftain class, how to be king, right? So this is the unnamed son. And this is Hnaf, and they kill each other. What's that doing? That's a dagger at the heart of this whole Germanic society, this whole Germanic culture. Okay? And I think what the poet's doing there is he's saying there's something unworkable in this kind of mentality, in this kind of culture. Right? Not unworkable in the sense of the fostering out of children, etc. But something unworkable in this. Okay? What's the feud? Best explanation of it, kind of in a modern pop culture context. If you've ever seen The Untouchables with Kevin Costner and Sean Connery, you know, Kevin Costner, the young, kind of green G-man, etc. Sean Connery, the old, tough, wizened Chicago cop. And Sean Connery has this one scene where he explains to Elliot Ness how things work in the real world. They hurt one of yours, you hurt one of theirs. They really hurt one of yours, you kill one of theirs. They get two of yours, you slaughter them. It's not just eye for an eye. It's both eyes for one eye. It's a mouthful of teeth for one tooth. It's, you touch a member of my family, I kill your family. Right? How does this kind of idea of a feud end?
Usually somebody takes over.
Keep going. How do they take over, though?
Kill everyone.
Okay? There's only one way this thing actually ultimately ever ends. One side is decimated. Genocide. Okay? One side is totally annihilated and destroyed. The last one left standing is the one that wins. But what's the problem with that? Okay, but is one side ever completely annihilated?
No.
No. So there's always going to be someone left. And they're going to want what? They're going to want revenge. You know, look at the Israelis and the Arabs. It's a perfect example. How far back does that, you know, rivalry, does that feud go? Abraham, Isaac, Ishmael. Abraham's son by the concubine. That's how far back it goes. Okay? Thousands of years. So, Wealthiel comes in, and she sees the good two, nephew and uncle, sitting near each other. Their peace was still whole then, each true to the other. What in the world is the poet talking about? The poet's talking about this. Let me do this a different way. We've got the hall. Here's Hrothgar. Okay. Over here's Hrothulf, his nephew. Wealthy Isle is probably kind of around here. Unferth is sitting down here at Hrothgar's feet, opposite them. Beowulf is sitting in the middle. Okay. She sees the two, the nephew and uncle, sitting like this. And the poet says there was still peace between them. Why? What does that mean, there was still? It means there won't always be. Okay. In other tales about Hrothgar's kingdom, and we have those tales, okay, it's pretty clear that Hrothulf attempts to usurp Hrothgar's throne, especially after his death. He doesn't kill his uncle, but he takes over after his death, right? Denying who the throne? Yeah. Hrothric's the eldest. Okay. He dies, then it's up to him. So she comes in and she says, or the poet says, where the two good sat, nephew and uncle, their peace was still holding, each true to the other. Likewise, Unferth, spokesman, sat at the foot of the Shielding Lord. Everyone trusted his spirit. That is, everyone trusted Unferth's spirit, that he had great courage. They trusted that he had great courage. This is the Christian poet from outside the poem inserting this. Though to his kinsmen he had not been merciful in swordplay, meaning he killed them. Okay? So, we're told there's going to be some kind of open enmity between these two. This guy is sitting at Hrothgar's feet, and he is a kinslayer. What's the poet doing? He's foreshadowing. He's telegraphing. If you have a kinslayer at the heart of the seat of power in your kingdom, guess what's going to happen? Yeah, you're going to have problems in that kingdom. Okay? So she addresses Beowulf. Excuse me. She addresses Hrothgar. Take this cup, my noble, courteous lord, giver of treasure. Be truly joyful, gold friend of men, and speak to the Geats in mild words as a man should do. In other words, she's saying, be nice, as one should. Be gracious to the Geats, mindful of the gifts which you now have from near and far. Be gracious, mindful of what you have, she's saying, be generous. You've got tons of wealth that you've received from near and far. I've been told that you would take this warrior for your son. And she kind of goes up and, I think, stands in front of Beowulf. And maybe does kind of this, pointing out that it's him. Herald's cleansed. Look around. It's all nice and shiny inside again. The bright ring hall. Use your many rewards where you can. In other words, go open up the vaults. And what? Leave to your kinsmen, the folk and kingdom, when you must go forth to face the Maker's decree. Give your treasure, or some of it at least, to Beowulf. But do what?
Leave the kingdom to your family.
Leave the kingdom to your boys. Because she's heard that you would take this warrior as a son, which means she thinks that means Beowulf's going to inherit the kingdom. Okay? I know that my own, and then she addresses Hrothulf. Okay, so she's kind of advised her husband, don't leave the kingdom to Beowulf, leave it to your own boys. And now she addresses Hrothulf. I know that my own dear, gracious Hrothulf will hold and honors these youths if you should give up the world before him, friend of the Shieldings. Okay? I'm in a very small minority in that I read those lines as being sarcasm. When she refers to Hrothulf as dear, gracious Hrothulf, she's essentially saying, whom I would trust like I would.
As far as I can throw.
Yeah. A poison adder. Okay. That he's going to do what? That he will hold in honor these ewes if you die before him. She's saying he'll protect them. He'll establish their rights. I expect that he would wish to repay both our sons kindly if he recalls all the pleasures and honors that we have shown him. If you die before him, he will repay them for all the honors and gifts that we've bestowed upon him. And then she turns to the bench where her boys sat, Hrethric and Hrothmun, and the son of heroes, Beowulf, between them. Okay. So what's the purpose of this little speech of hers? Louder? Okay. Possibly. I think her little speech isn't directed at Hrothulf. I think her little speech is actually directed at Beowulf. I think she is saying to Beowulf, because she's going to make it clearer in a later speech. Don't trust him. She's going to tell Beowulf after he kills Grendel's mother and before he leaves. She's going to say, keep an eye on my boys. Be a help to them if they ever need it. And Beowulf says, don't worry. If your boys ever need help, I will come at the head of 1,000 soldiers to defend them. Okay? And I think what the poet is doing there is the poet is suggesting he knows these other stories about the enmity between Hrothulf and Hrothgar. And he's including that here to show, okay, this idea of this family feud will tear this culture apart, okay? And he does that one way, at least, by tracing that whole idea of feud, what? All the way back to Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel, the murder of Abel by Cain, produces what in the world? Monsters. Monstrous behavior. Okay? And anybody, therefore, involved in a feud, I think this is the Christian poet saying this, or suggesting this, is monstrous. Right? So, she then gives treasure. Hrothgar's given treasure, and now she gives treasure. She gives him armlets, she gives him garments and rings, and she gives him the greatest neck collar ever heard of anywhere on earth. A neck collar in Celtic, it's called a torque, T-O-R-C. Okay? And it's probably a collar made of several braids of twisted gold. Has two kind of little knobs on the end, and it can be opened up like this, and then closed to put back on. And the poet immediately launches into what's called the first of the Frisian raid digressions. Okay, the character Healak, Beowulf's uncle, is going to be referred to three times in the poem as making this Frisian raid. This is the first one. Okay? The poet alludes to it three different times. Why? Because the poet is showing what an idiot Healak was. Healak's name means lack thought. So he's not so smart up here. Okay. He was also, historically, he was referred to as a giant. Okay. Historical sources that talk about Healak say he was the largest man alive at the time. And one of them even says, and you can go to his grave on an island in the middle of the Rhine and see his bones. In other words, it was like an open crypt kind of a thing. Okay? He was supposed to be, if I remember right, something like 7 or 8 feet tall. So, big guy. Big guy, little brain, essentially. So, Healak goes on this journey. And he wears this golden neck ring that Wealhtheow gave Beowulf. Okay? And we're told he dies there. Line 12:10. Into Frankish hands came the life of that king. His breast garments, the great collar too, etc., etc. And then we're told the hall swallowed the noise. That is, not the noise about Helix, Frisian Raid, because that's not been sung. It means the noise of just the celebration that's going on. And Wealthio comes, and she speaks to Beowulf again. And this is when she actually hands him the ring, the neck ring. Wear this neck ring in good health and enjoy this war garment, treasure of a people, blah, 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 blah. You've made it so that men will praise you far and near, forever and ever, as wide as the seas, home of the winds, surround the shores of earth. Be while you live, blessed, O noble. I wish you well with these bright treasures. Be to my sons kind in your deeds, keeping them in joys. Okay, so Beowulf's still sitting there between her boys, who are young at this point. Probably 10, 11 years old. And then she says, here, each earl is true to the other. Mild in his heart, that is, not plotting. Loyal to his liege lord, that is, Hrothgar. The thanes united, the nation alert, the troop having drunk at my table will do as I bid. In other words, she's kind of saying, and these guys will also take orders from me, too. Okay. What does she mean by that? What has she just told Beowulf? Be kind in your deeds to my son. And she says, and generally, everybody at this table does what I tell them to do. So, be nice to my boys. This is kind of like a command. She goes and sits down. We're told it's the best to feast. The men drank wine, and they did not know weird. Weird, the best modern English translation is fate. Okay? Well, what fate? One would come that night and kill one of them. Okay? They lay down. They go to sleep. Line 1252 or so, and one paid sorely for his evening rest, as had often happened. Okay? We get another allusion to Cain and Grendel and the feud between Grendel and God. And Grendel's mother comes, 1279. And she seizes one, but we're told line 1300, just before then, Beowulf wasn't there that night. Well, frankly, would it really have mattered if Asher was sleeping in front of the door? No, because Beowulf would have watched. Okay. And we're told, then the wise old king, 1306 or 7, gray-bearded warrior, was grieved at heart when he learned that he no longer lived, the dearest of men, his chief thane, was dead. Beowulf was fetched. Beowulf comes in. And he says, so, did you have a good night's sleep? And Hrothgar says, ask not of joys. Sorrow is renewed for the Danish people. Asherah is dead. Elder brother of Eirmund laughed. My confidant, my counselor, my shoulder companion, blah, 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 blah. And then he mentions, oh, by the way, Grendel had a mother. It's then that he mentions, we've seen two of these monsters walking the moors. See, Beowulf never knew there were two. Okay. So he talks about Grendel's mother, and then he talks about Grendel's home. See, Beowulf didn't go off to Grendel's mere after he killed Grendel. Hrothgar's mere did. And he describes Grendel's mere. That murky land, about line 1357, that murky land they hold, wolf-haunted slopes, windy headlands, awful fin paths, where the upland torrents plunge downward under the dark crags, the flood underground. It's not far hence. And he describes what you can see there every night. Fire on the water. Sea serpents. this hoary frost on the trees that grow on the cliff that overhangs the mere. Interestingly, there are two other texts that have this exact same description of a place. One is called the Vision of St. Paul, and another one is one of the what's called Blickling Homilies. I think it's either homily 11 or 17. Blickling is the name of the house that owns the manuscript where the homily is. And the place that they describe in the Blickling homily and in the Vision of St. Paul is the same place. It's the entrance to hell. And the Beowulf poet has the exact same description. It's a murky mirror. It has sea monsters in it. You see fire at night on the water. It has a slope, a rocky slope, kind of around the back of it. On that slope are overhanging trees, and the trees are always covered in hoarfrost. Exact same description, all three texts. Only thing is, we don't know which text is the earliest. We don't know which ones borrow it from the other one. Or if they all three get it from a similar source, right? But it's kind of interesting that Grendel lives at the entrance to hell, even though it's not referred to that as that in the poem. So what does Hrothgar do? Seek it if you dare, and I'll give you more treasure. Okay, what do you never do to a hero like Beowulf? You never dare. Because what are they going to do? Well, I'm a hero. Of course I'll do it. Okay. Does he know what Grendel's mother's like? All he knows is that she's not as big as Grendel. Because Hrothgar says, the second of them, as far as they could discern, most clearly had the shape of a woman. The other, misshapen, marched the exile's path in the form of a man. He was called Grendel. Okay. That's all he knows. So Beowulf says, sorrow not, wise one. It is always better to avenge one's friend than to mourn over much. What does he mean, sorrow not, wise one? Okay, that's kind of polite language. What's Beowulf really saying? Get over yourself. Yeah, quit your whining. You're a warrior, for God's sake. Suck it up. Okay? Why? Because it's better to avenge your friend than to mourn, just than to mourn? Than to mourn over much. He's saying, Hrothgar, you're a puddle of tears. Come on. Each of us must await the end of this world's life. Guess what? Today was Asherah's day. Tomorrow may be my day. Maybe today is your day. Right? Each of us must die. Let him who can bring about fame before death. Why? Because in the Germanic system, fame, glory, was everything. Because what does fame and glory ensure? Exactly. Your story will be told after you die. Or, to put it another way, a way that moderns would kind of put it, people don't want to die thinking that nobody will never know they lived. People don't want to die thinking they haven't made a difference. They want people to know they existed. That's what Beowulf's saying. It's okay to die. What? When people remember you afterwards. You know, the purpose of a eulogy is to do what? To put that good word in people's minds so they won't forget the dead person. Okay? Let him who can bring about fame before death. That is best for the unliving man after he is gone. Nothing about going off to be with Jesus in heaven Why? Because the poet isn't writing Christian schlock, Christian crap. Right? And I say that as a Christian. I don't mean, you know, all Christians write crap. I mean, he's not, oh, just believe and everything will be okay and you'll go and live with Jesus and play your little harp sitting on a cloud. He's not doing that. Okay? So, arise, kingdom's guard. Let's go find him. Notice he doesn't say, I'll do it, Hrothgar. You stay here and be safe. He's saying, get up.
Let's go.
Let's go. I promise you this. He will find no protection, not in the belly of the earth, nor the bottom of the sea, nor the mountain groves. Let him go where he will. The he is referring to Grendel's mother, but Beowulf does actually use a male pronoun. Okay? For today you must endure patiently all your woes, as I expect you will. Has Hrothgar endured patiently all his previous woes? The 12 years of Grendel's ravages? He has endured it. Was he patient?
No.
What does that endured patiently imply?
He would have remained faithful to God instead of going over to pagan.
Yeah, instead of reverting back to the pagan temples, seeking out the slayer of souls. Right? No, Hrothgar never expected anything to change. Bearing things patiently means bearing things in the hope it'll eventually get better. Okay? Hrothgar, notice, leaps up. Thanked the Lord, the mighty God, for that man's speech. So what kind of speech did Beowulf give him?
Encouragement.
Encouragement. Inspiration. This was his halftime pep talk. You know, Hrothgar, we're down. 49 zip. Go out there and win one for the Gipper. Let's. Okay. So, they get Hrothgar's horse ready. The foot soldiers are ready. They walk on along. They shoot, you know, the sea monsters and stuff. They come across, they come around a bend, and they're on a rock wall or a cliffside. What do they see? Asherah's head. Just, you know, kind of a standing height, looking at him. Okay. Grendel's mother knows something about presentation. She knows how to scare. Okay. So, what does Beowulf do? How did he fight Grendel?
Bare hands,
unarmed. No sword, no shield, no armor. How does he fight Grendel's mama? He arms to the teeth. He's putting everything on, we're told. Beowulf, 1441, geared up in his warrior's clothing, cared not for his life. The broad war shirt, blah, 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 the helmet. And what else does he do? He switches swords with Unferth. Okay? Unferth offers him his sword, and Beowulf takes it. And notice we're told, 1465, the son of Edgeloth, that is Unferth, did not remember what he had said before, drunk with wine, when he challenged Beowulf. So the poet is saying he really was drunk then and had no idea what he was saying. Okay. Was Beowulf drunk when he replied, you're the slayer of your own kin? No, he hadn't had anything to drink yet. Okay. So Beowulf addresses Edgethiau. It says, before I go, I just want you to know, you'll always be like a father to me. Be a protector to my men. And if I don't come back, send, notice, all the treasure you've given me off to Helak. Why? Well, because in Beowulf's mind, it's already Helak's. See, he didn't win treasure for himself. He won treasure for his king. This is what thanes did if they won battles. All that treasure would be brought to the king. It is then incumbent upon the king to distribute that treasure. See, one of the marks, really the hallmark of a good king, is to give out that treasure. A bad king hoards it and keeps it for himself. And bad kings always come to bad ends. Okay. And he says, let Unferth have that ancient heirloom. That is, let Unferth have your father's sword that you gave me. How are you doing that? There we go. Okay. So, he walks to the edge of the water and dives in. And your book tells you, line 1495, it was the space of a day, or it was daylight, before he could perceive the bottom. The Old English reads, Tha was huil dagas, ere he thon a grunwang onyeten mechta. Literally, that was a time of the day before he that bottom might perceive. Okay? The way it's often translated, it was the greater part of a day before he could perceive the bottom of the lake. Well, what's the greater part of a day? Literally, scientifically, let's say. 12 hours, 1 minute. Right? A day is 24 hours. Okay, it doesn't mean literally 12 hours, 1 minute. It probably means metaphorically. So what does it mean then? How long did Beowulf have to hold his breath to get to the bottom of the mirror? Not 5 minutes. Not 10 minutes. Hours! Okay? Is this humanly possible?
No.
No. Beowulf isn't like the rest of us. But one scholar, a very, very famous scholar, guy who used to be at University of Tennessee, he's dead now, wrote an article about Beowulf where he tries to demythologize, or to use his term, demarvelize Beowulf's superhuman exploits. And this is the first one that he addresses. He says, no, it wasn't the better part of a day. It just means for a long time. A long time meaning what? A long time for anyone to be able to hold their breath. I don't know how long Navy SEALs can generally hold their breath. It's a pretty good amount of time because they have to do that 30-foot pool thing where they're chained and they have to go down to the bottom and then they have like a certain amount of time to get unchained. It's one of the things they used to do. I don't think they do it anymore because they had too many deaths in SEAL training. This is at Pensacola. So what does he mean? Well, he held his breath for like 3 minutes, or maybe 4 minutes, and then he saw the bottom. We're going to see later on another one of the Frisian raids. Beowulf is the only one to leave that raid. He's the only survivor of the Geats. He survives by killing all the other Frisians, okay? And he takes all of their armor, 30 suits of armor, which he holds in one hand. And then he swims home. Okay?
Beowulf's supposed to be a big man.
The textbook says he swims home. Or the text says he swims home. Robinson says, no, it's not really what it says. It says he rows. He gets in a boat and rows home. No, not really. Okay? Anyways, takes him the better part of a day to perceive the bottom. He gets partway down. And the poet tells us that she who held that expanse of water ruled there for 100 half years. So Grendel's mother has lived there. That's been her kingdom for 50 years. And we're going to see three times in the poem somebody rules for 50 years. This is the first. She rules there for 50 years. Hrothgar later on is going to tell us he ruled for 100 half years before Grendel came. And then we're going to find out Beowulf rules for 50 years before the dragon comes. Okay? Nobody really knows why. Why the 50 is important. Okay? And so what does she do? She grabs him. She grabs him. She drags him down to the bottom. She takes him into her cave. She's got some kind of airtight cave. Okay, and she's sitting there stabbing at him. And Beowulf perceives he's in a hall, line 15, 13 or so, where water can't harm him, and he sees firelight, that is, he sees a fire in this hall. Okay? He swings the sword, because he's able to break free for a moment. He swings Unfair's sword, and it breaks. By the way, this happens every time with Beowulf. When he swings a human-made sword in the poem. Every time. One reason is because he has the strength of 30 men in each grip. These swords aren't made for the strength of sixty men in a swing. Because imagine what that means. That's a lot of power. Okay, it's a lot of thrust. It's not, the steel isn't tempered well enough. Okay. And it bing bounces off her. So what happens? He realizes that's not gonna work. And we're told, but he doesn't give up. So he trusts in his strength, line 1532 or so. The might of his hand grip. And he grabs her by the shoulder. And swings her around so that she falls to the ground. She quickly gives him requital for that, we're told, with a grim grasp and grapples him to her. And we're told, weary, he stumbled, strongest of warriors, of foot soldiers, and took a fall. Now, it falls on our deaf ears. But that's an Anglo-Saxon joke. How is it a joke? Look what we're told. He is the strongest of warriors. And then the poet tells us what kind of warriors. Of foot soldiers. And he took a fall. This would be like Muhammad Ali at the height of his boxing prowess, taunting George Foreman, in the ring, doing his dance and saying, dance like a butterfly, sting like a bee. And when he's dancing, doing his rope-a-dope, he trips and falls. That would have been hilarious at the Thriller in Manila, okay, which I watched. That's what's being said here. Beowulf is the greatest of infantrymen, and he trips over his own 2 feet and falls. But that's not even the funniest part, because then what happens? She set upon her hall guest. Lewis is translating that kind of in the Southern American English use of set. She went to. No. The Old English is she offsat. She set. Beowulf falls. She plops down on him with her little dagger and starts going, you know, playing psycho on him. She starts stabbing him. Okay? That's meant to be funny. I think an Anglo-Saxon audience would probably be laughing at that point. But her little dagger can't do any good. Why not? Because Beowulf has a mail coat that was made by a god. Wayland the Smith. The Germanic god of forges and smithying. And it defended him. And we're told he would have died there. Beowulf would have. Had it not been for his armored shirt, and holy God brought about war victory. The shirt and God. How do we know? Because the wise Lord, ruler of the heavens, decided it rightly, easily, once he stood up again. Okay. That one word that Lyusa translates as once. And it's this. Sidon. It's often just translated since. Okay? But it can be translated as since, because, for. Okay? Look at that line again. The wise Lord, ruler of the heavens, decided it rightly, easily, something he stood up again. Because he stood up again? For he stood up again? Since he stood up again? What comes first? Beowulf standing or God's deciding? See how you translate that little conjunction. That little adverbial conjunction indicates which comes first. God making the decision or Beowulf standing up. Okay? And so what happens? He stands up and what? He sees on the wall a big old sword hanging on the wall. Why do you hang things on the wall? Why are those things there and these things here?
To admire it or to...
Decoration. She's a freaking monster. And she has decor in her house.
She's still a woman.
I've got to put that on Facebook. She's still a woman. Because I have a former graduate student who's teaching Beowulf. She'll love that. Oh, by the way, if you're on Twitter, which I have a Twitter account, but I never use it, check this out.
Beowulf Trump.
It is absolutely hilarious. A benevolist at University of Virginia started this the other day. I mean, he started just doing some tweets as Beowulf Trump. And then he set up a whole Beowulf at Trump account or Beowulf Trump account. Uses the poem and throws in all these Trumpisms, you know. The Geats, I love the Geats. They're the greatest, the most amazing people. You know, Hrothgar, he's a wimp. If I had been there, Grendel never would have come. You know, just it's genius. It really is sheer genius. Okay, so Beowulf finds this sword. He whips it off the wall, and seemingly in one fluid motion, he takes it and kills her. Okay, what kind of sword is it? Well, we're told it's a giant sword. A giantish sword. Okay? Lost my voice. This is section 23, best of weapons. He sees it, he cuts her, she dies. Notice, the flames and the fire suddenly jump up. Like there's some kind of magic involved, or something's happened. Beowulf looks around and he sees all kinds of treasure. And then what does he do? He goes to find Grendel's body. Okay. He finds Grendel, chops his head off, and the corpse bursts open, we're told. Why? You're driving down the road, you're driving down a little country road, and you see a possum on the side of the road. It's bloated. Bales, you know, everything all over. Soon as he chops Grendel's head off, notice the troops back up. Meanwhile, at the top of the pond, see what? The water starts doing this. Starts bubbling. And what does it start bubbling? Blood and ooze and gore starts coming up. And Hrothgar and his men think, sucks to be Beowulf. Okay, they think he's dead. They leave. And the poet says, line 1600, I've got a lot to go through. The ninth hour came. Thakom non dias. Then came the ninth hour. So, what does that mean? A couple of things. The Germanic people did not reckon time that way. Okay, the ninth hour is biblical usage. First, third, sixth, ninth, twelfth. Okay? The ninth hour was when? Into thy hands I commit my spirit. And Christ dies on the cross. Okay? What's the poet doing? He's using that elusively to suggest that in the mind of the people around the lake, This is like the death of Christ. They don't know Christ. Okay? So it's written for a Christian audience who sees all that blood and gore, and they think, oh, I get it. That is suggesting Christ's death. The only problem is, Beowulf isn't dead, right? And Beowulf isn't Christ. He is a type of Christ. That is, he is a figure of. He doesn't represent. Okay? He's a figure like Moses is a figure of Christ. Or David is a figure of Christ. Or Samson is a figure of Christ. That is, a deliverer. Okay? So the ninth hour came. The Scyldings go back home because they think he's dead. And Baal's men do what? They sit. Because they think he's dead. And they just stare into the mirror. Meanwhile, back down at the bottom of the mirror, the sword melts. Okay? And Beowulf doesn't get any other treasures, but he grabs Grendel's head, he takes the sword, he jumps out through the cave, he swims to the top, and his men see him, and were told that splendid troop of thanes went towards him, thank God, this is line 1623, rejoiced in the prince that they might see him safe and sound. So he gives them the head, they carry it, they go back to Heorot. They're carrying the head on spears until they get into the hall. And then what do his men do? They set the head down on the floor, neck side down, and they grab it by the hair, so Grendel does have hair, and they drag it down the length of the hall. What does this do? It spreads blood, brain matter. You know, cerebellum, gets dragged on the floor. What's going on in the hall at this time? Hrothgar and his people are having another feast. Like, they didn't even give Beowulf's body time to cool, you know, before they start eating. And you have to imagine the women are going, as they see. So Beowulf says, gives his speech. Here's Grendel's head. Why does he bring Grendel's head back? Trophy. What else? What does it indicate?
Prove they're safe.
Keep going. Why are they safe now?
Because he killed Grendel's mother.
Yeah. This is proof she's dead. He doesn't bring Grendel's mother's head. He brings Grendel's. Because the idea is, I couldn't have gotten this if she was still alive. Okay? So he brings the hilt, and he gives the hilt to Hrothgar, and I'm not going to be able to finish, get as far today as I needed to. He gives the hilt to Hrothgar, and we're told, line 1678 or so, it was placed in his hand, the wise old leader, that old work of giants, that is the sword hilt. It's an old work of giants. Okay. And Hrothgar spoke, 1687, but he doesn't. Instead, for the next 11 lines, he studies the hilt. And what does he see? He sees written there that it's carved in runes. Or maybe even a little kind of stick figure drawing. He sees written there the origin of ancient strife when the flood slew rushing seas the race of giants. They suffered awfully. Now, this might be Noah's flood that is referred to. Okay. That was a people alien to the eternal Lord. A last reward the ruler gave them through the raging waters. Also on the sword, in rune letters, was who it belonged to. Okay. And we've got swords that survive from the Anglo-Saxon period that have runic letters that say, this was made for Alf. Or, Alfred had me made. Things that have been found, thrown in rivers, ponds, etc. Then Hrothgar delivers a long speech. And this is where we're going to stop. This speech is called, usually, one of two things. Hrothgar's homily, or Hrothgar's sermon. Okay? We'll pick up at 1700 on Tuesday.